There is an endless song echoes in my soul, and I hear the music ring. And though the storms may come, I am holding on to singing your praise. How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? No, I am loved by the King, and it makes my
in the troubled times, sing when I wear. I can sing when I lose my step and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up. Sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you hear me. From singing your praise, how can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my King, and it makes my heart. I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart want to sing.
Good morning, and welcome to the coast. We are coming to you from beautiful New Smyrna Beach, Florida, and we are so happy you've decided to join us today. We live in incredibly uncertain times, and there's so many things happening and we just don't know how they're going to turn out. And that can lead us to become anxious, or it can lead us to lose hope. But Jerry is going to show us how to embrace uncertainty by relying on the one thing that we know is certain, that you can trust God. So go ahead and get your coffee and find a good place to sit, maybe on your couch, on the patio, or maybe by your pool, and join us as we begin. Here is Common Ground Band.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks for singing with us this morning.
If all the plans I make are wrong, your love stays the same. Your light will guide me through it all. I'm hanging on, I'm leaning in to you. Nothing can reach the end of all your faithfulness. Your grace is with me through every shadow. I'm hanging on, I'm leaning in to you. I don't know where you'll take me, but I know you're always good. My hope is built on nothing less than your we to you.
Oh, Father, we sing to you today because you're worthy. We sing you these words because they're not just words on the screen, but they're the prayers of our heart. I trust your heart and I trust your name, Lord. When the storms gather around us, Lord, we want to cling to you because you are strength. You are the place of hope.
My hope is built on nothing less than your great love, your righteousness. To light, now we're alive, now we're alive. We are here to lift you up, here to sing a song of love, here to give you, God, what you are worthy of. A holy roar, reaching for heaven.
Singing with this guy.
All right. Hey, everyone. Glad that you're able to join us today. Hopefully you have power on. I don't know whether you noticed or not, but Jen in her introduction usually says we're coming to you live, and because of the storm that's that we're probably going through right now as you're watching this on Sunday morning, we're actually doing this a little bit ahead of time, which just is just one more thing in this year, isn't it? I mean, I've called this year the year of I can't believe, you know, this is happening. Are you kidding me? And so I even went to get a Chick-fil-A sandwich in Port Orange the other day, and our Chick-fil-A is closed for 2 months. So on top of everything else, no Chick-fil-A. So we got all that kind of thing kind of going on. But anyway, last week we started a new series called Messed Up, and we said that, you know, we live in some, like Jen said at the beginning, just some crazy times, extraordinary times. These are times that we're going to look back on, you know, and our kids and our grandkids are going to look back on history and say, wow, they went through that. And just some incredible things are happening, and it just seems like it's a perfect storm kind of thing. And so, you know, there's just so much uncertainty about, you know, around here, like about school and, of course, about the weather and our health and just everything that's going on. So we want to talk about that for a few weeks. So one of the things we said last week is that this is nothing new. In fact, you go back in Scripture, and there's story after story after story, and the stories that we have in the Bible were written in just at times of extraordinary uncertainty, and we just went through some of Moses and Joseph and David, and even in the birth of Jesus, and in every single story that you read where it seems like things had spun out of control and where all the momentum seemed backwards and everything seemed headed in the wrong direction and all of God's activity seemed to stop and the bad guys are winning and the evil king is winning and the gods of the pagan empire are winning. You read those stories and you find that in the middle of extraordinary uncertainty, there is God. And nothing had changed and He was in control all the time and that He had the whole world in His hands. And one of those stories that we ended with last week and kind of just got started in it, we'll kind of wrap it today. One of those stories involves Jesus and what we call the Last Supper. And you know this story. He had gathered with His closest followers for what's going to turn out to be His last meal with them. And they're just beginning to realize that the tide of public opinion is turning against Jesus and is turning against them. And everything that was going so well just a few weeks before is now beginning to fall apart. And they don't know what to do next. And so Scripture says this, that as they were eating, that Jesus took some bread and He blessed it. And then He broke it into pieces and He gave it to His disciples and said, take, for this is My body. He said, this is not what you think. And this was the Passover meal. Again, we talked about this a little bit last week, but He reminded them, you've been taking this Passover meal for like 1400 years now. Ever since you were little kids, and the 1400 years and the Passover commemorates the time that the Jews had been freed from slavery in Egypt. So every year they had this celebration and they shared this meal. He said, but from now on, it's going to be different. From now on, whenever you break this bread, you're going to think that's the body of Jesus that was broken for me. And you want to say, well wait, if you're one of the disciples, wait a minute, Jesus, this is all that death talk again. This is all that negativity. We really don't want to hear it. And if you're from God, certainly you're going to turn things around. And if you're from God, certainly things are going to start going well. And there's going to be more certainty and not less certainty. And He looked at them and Scripture says that then He took a cup of wine and He gave thanks to God for it. And He gave it to each of them and they all drank from it. And He said to them, this is My blood, which confirms the covenant between God and His people. And I'm going to be poured out as a sacrifice for many. And in doing this, He kind of foreshadows what's going to take place just hours later when He is going to be taken and His broken body is going to be nailed to a cross and His blood is going to be shed. But anyway, these guys, they leave the room and they begin to go to the Garden of Gethsemane and there's just so much drama there and you know the story and the soldiers and Judas coming and betraying Jesus with a kiss and the news gets worse. As they're going there, Jesus told them, and all of you guys are going to desert Me, all of you. But after I'm raised from the dead, I will go ahead of you to Galilee and I will meet you there. And Peter's just kind of following along and he's thinking, you know, enough about the bad news. And he says, Jesus, even if everyone deserts you, I will never, ever desert you, and I'll never deny you. And just a few short hours later, that very same man, with all of his talk, is going to listen to the voices of some men and even a little girl as they accuse him of being one of the followers of Jesus. And he's going to deny Jesus 3 times. And here's my question for you, and here's my question for me today. As we move into this series, and as we continue to experience uncertainty in our families and in our nation and in our leadership and maybe in your job and with our economy or your retirement or your health or your children or your marriage, with all of this uncertainty that's going on around us now, here's the question. Can you trust God? Can I trust God with all of the uncertainty? Can all of us trust God? Can we maintain a faith in God when there's absolutely no evidence of His activity in our life? Can we continue to embrace a strong faith in God as a personal Heavenly Father when there seems to be no evidence of His activity in our culture and in our world? And I want you to know that your answer to that question will determine your response to the continuing uncertainty in your family and in your job, in this economy, in your health, in your family, and all of those things. And here's the dilemma that you and I face. And for the next few weeks, I'm going to keep pointing to this, because especially for Americans who seem to equate the blessings of God with prosperity. And by the way, why shouldn't we? We have been so incredibly blessed as a people. And we've always equated God with being prosperous and equated God with forward motion and equated God and His presence as, you know, with a physical, tangible blessing that we have, and something good happens and we say, God has just blessed us. And why shouldn't we say stuff like that? This has been our experience for many, many, many years. But, you know, I just imagine that if we were to go to those disciples about 3 to 6 months, maybe after the resurrection of Jesus, and if we were to kind of get them to sit with us and say, guys, while you were following Jesus, when was the darkest moment? When was the moment when you gave up hope? When there was the least amount of hope? When was the time when you were the least certain? And I believe they would tell you that it began when they gathered around that dinner table. And they listen to Jesus and they realize that things might not get better. And they would say, it's when we gathered around the table that night and He said, hey, things are going to get worse. And that not only would one of us betray Him, but that we would all run away. And we all did. And then we saw Him arrested and we saw Him on trial and we saw Him beaten and we saw Him crucified and we saw Him died. And they would say, that was the darkest time. And when we saw all of this, we said, we need to give up because God's not anywhere near this place. And then if you were to ask them, well, where in your time with Jesus do you think that God was doing His greatest work? Was it when He healed that lame man, or was it when He healed the blind guy? Or maybe it was when He stood outside the tomb of Lazarus and Jesus, Lazarus had been in the grave for literally 4 stinking days and Jesus raised him back to life. Was that the time that you felt that God was doing His greatest work? When was it that you knew God was doing His most? And they would say this. They would say, you know what? It was those same hours that it seemed like He was doing the least. Those very same hours when it seemed like He was absent, when it seemed like He was missing. And they would say, because in those darkest, darkest hours, God was doing His greatest work. And in those darkest hours when it seemed like He was inactive, that's when He was the most active. Because those darkest hours were the epicenter of the salvation of mankind. And those would be the hours that literally for thousands of years, people all over the world would look back to and rejoice in God's goodness and grace. But if you had asked us at the time when it was going on, we would have said, game over. We've wasted our time following Him. God is not here at all. But now, they would say, now we know different. And you know what? That's a difficult message for me. And that's a difficult message for you. And that is a difficult message for American Christians. And yet, it is our story. For those of us who have determined to follow Jesus, and specifically for those of us who have placed our faith in trust in Jesus, it's our story because it's in the Bible, but it's not just because it's in the Bible. It's our story because it's our experience that God seems to take broken things and do His most amazing work. That it seems sometimes like God waits until we're just about ready to give up hope, and then He does His most amazing work. That God tends to take broken and hopeless situations, and He shows up in a way, and it's not the way that we would have chosen, because we would never allow things to get as bad as they often get. But we find out, well, wait a minute, this was God's way. And this was what God wanted. And the greatest things begin in the biggest messes. And the most amazing works of God I've found. And you see them in Scripture, and we've experienced in our life, and many of you have as well. The most amazing works of God are launched at a time of personal and even national brokenness. This is what God does. And the question then for you and the question for me is, will we maintain our faith even when we don't see Him at work, even when we don't see His hand? And as our faith begins to stutter, and as our faith begins to shake just a little bit, and as our faith begins to waver, and as we begin to look to the left, and we begin to look to the right, and we begin to look at the circumstances, and we begin to doubt, now more than ever, this Bible, this library of Scripture is the place to go because of all of these stories and all of these words. And we know that the story of our salvation was birthed at a time of extraordinary darkness and extraordinary uncertainty. Now, you hear that and you say, well, Jerry, that's really great and it's very inspirational. But how's that going to help me get a job? And how's that going to help my kids do right? And how's that? I mean, nothing's going to change tomorrow. And how's that going to change the mess that my marriage seems to be in? And you know, it doesn't make my health any better. And you know what? You're right. And let me just be honest with you this morning and say this, that there is never, I've been here 30 years, there has never been a time when as a church leader that I wish I could figure out faster, or I wish I could figure out quicker how we could do things and how I could do things to help people more, because that's our message. But here is what I know, all right? That although that idea, that insight, that truth about that Scripture doesn't change, that it doesn't change anything about our circumstances. But here's what it does. It allows you to embrace uncertainty with the certainty of knowing that God is still in control. Let me shrink it down to this. Here's your takeaway today. That although life, and even when life is uncertain, that God is always certain. God is always certain. And that although life is uncertain, and your family might be uncertain, and your health might be uncertain, and the economy is uncertain, and of course our world is uncertain, God is not uncertain. And embracing this knowledge, and in fact, even barely hanging on to it as truth, will keep you and I from making decisions that further complicate the difficulties that we're already in. And knowing this and embracing this principle will allow you and I to go to bed at night knowing that there's a way to have peace even in the middle of all the uncertainty. And it'll teach us to begin to keep an eye out for the activity of God that just may take us by surprise. And you go back and you read some of those stories in Scripture and things are going on and they're going bad and all of a sudden they realize, wait a minute, God's here and He's at work, and it takes them by surprise many times. But just to hang on to it and to embrace the simple truth that even though life is uncertain, God is not uncertain. And not only does He have the whole world in His hands, He has your whole world in His hands. And He has my whole world in His hands as well. Now, that is very easy for me to sit up here and say, because I don't have to get up in a few minutes and go out the door and get in your car and go to your home and step into your circumstances. I do not have to get up in the morning like I know many people in our church family do and say, I wonder how I'm going to get through this day. I don't have to go home and figure out how I'm going to stay in school. And I realize that our circumstances, and there's so many of us, are all very different. And what gives me the nerve to sit up here and to try and encourage you, I want you to know, is more than just trying to paint some pretty picture in the sky. And today is more than just a pep talk so that you'll go out and maintain your faith. And especially to some of you who are watching this and you're new to the faith, or maybe you've been burned in a church experience before, you've had a bad experience, or maybe you've watched a parent go through a difficult time and the church that you were in just kind of kept, you know, pumping everybody up with all this sweet message, but you never saw it make a difference. I want you to know I understand that. But here is what I would say to you and to me and to all of us and all of you watching. And Paul wrote this in Romans. He said, we know, we are certain that in all things God works to the benefit of those who love Him. And let me say that when your life is uncertain, God is not uncertain. And He still has your whole world in His hands. And He still has my whole world in His hands. And He has your family in His hands. And He has your health in His hands. And He has your job and your children and your personal finances in His hands. Our God works, Scripture tells us, and He's active and He's present in all things to the benefit of those who love Him and who are called according to His purpose. So I'm not the smartest guy in the world. I try and read and try and keep up, but I don't know what the future holds for us any more than anyone else. But I do know that when life is uncertain, that God is not. And regardless of what you see and regardless of what you do not see, you have the opportunity to embrace a God who is faithful. And not only that, but He is strong and He is in control and He's still on His throne and He still has the whole world in His hands. But more importantly, He has your world in His hands. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for this time that we have to gather this morning all over our area, all around our country, and even different countries in the world. And God, if there is one word that could describe the next week, month, 6 months, it would be the word uncertain. That there are just things we have no idea. We're making plans for this and that, but they can literally change tomorrow. They can change on just a turn of the calendar page, a turn of the hour on our clock. And so God, we, there are so many things that are uncertain. And because of that, God, it's easy to give up hope. And it's easy to just throw up our hands and say, well, I guess whatever happens, I'll just have to sit here. But we are assured of something, that God is certain. And that the things He does, that He is working in our lives, even when we don't see it, and he tells us that it's going to be to our benefit. God, we know that's true, not just because we've picked it up and we've read it in Scripture. We know it's true because we've all experienced it. We've seen people experience it. So we know that God is faithful and that He's true and that He's certain and that He works for our benefit. So Father, we're counting on that. We're counting on that. And Father, we are so thankful for Your love for us. We're thankful for Jesus today. We're thankful for Your patience with us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, so we've been talking the last 2 weeks about the certainty of God. So next week, you're going to like it. We're going to be talking about the role that prayer plays in this. And so many people during this time have said, I wish I could pray better. I wish I could develop a kind of, you know, prayer life and time as I should. You know, prayer is really something that all of us can do. And you really can't get it wrong and talking to God. So we'll talk about that. We're going to talk about praying for His faithfulness and beginning to look not at our circumstances, but at the faithfulness of God. We can learn to trust in His promises and not our ability to understand, all right? I'd love to communicate with you about any of this. If you have any questions about anything I said today, or maybe questions about prayer and things we're going to talk about, maybe you just want to share a prayer request with me, you can email me at jfincher13@gmail.com. I will get back with you just as fast as I can. And again, We've taped this, and so this will be on Sunday morning. And for our folks in this local area here, we pray that you're safe. If you need any help, if you need anything, please do not be afraid to let us know. All right? God bless you guys. See you soon.
Hey guys, thanks again for joining us on this Sunday. We are bringing you those three things that we learned from our very own Beach Street building. We've been doing a little bit of renovation since we last met, and we just want to give you a small little glimpse of what we've been doing. But here, let's go ahead and get to our three things. You can embrace extraordinary uncertainty with the certainty of knowing that God is in control. Embracing uncertainty, knowing that God is in control, will teach us to keep an eye out for the activity of God that we do not even realize was happening. God not only has the whole world in His hands, He has your whole world in His hands. All right, guys, that's all three of them. I hope you have a great day, and we'll see you next week.